Good evening. God's blessings to you on this Good Friday evening and the day we commemorate what Martin Luther called Jesus' victory over sin, death, and the power of the devil. And because of what he did on the cross for us on Good Friday, we know that even though we battle with sin in this world, there will be a day when we are free from sin in heaven. And although we have to all face physical death in this world, there will be a day when there will be no more grief or crying or pain or death ever again when we are in heaven for eternity. And although we have to struggle against the devil in this world, we will be free from him in heaven as well. And so those are the promises that we have because of Good Friday. And in many ways, Good Friday is the most important day on our church calendar because of what happened on that day and what was won on that day by Jesus on the cross. And so we're going to remember that day tonight, and it was a dark day, and so as the service goes on, we are going to be darkening the church. We call it the tenebrae service, tenebrae meaning darkness, and we'll gradually darken the church until it is completely dark at the very end of the service. We have a few things that I want to say. First of all, just thank you to some folks who are taking part in the service tonight. Always want to say thank you to our guys back there on sound and on video, Tracy Glenn tonight, and Gary's back there. Gary's been setting some things up, and Gary and Cindy and June and Gail. And also back here, our choir, thank you so much for your number tonight and the blessings that you bring to us throughout the year. Thank you to Lorraine for playing tonight, and Tom. Tom's going to be helping me with the readings tonight, so thank you to Tom Kloster for that. So wanted to mention those folks before we get into the service, because there won't be any, we're going to try to keep it quiet and calm during the service. Also, I wanted to mention our Easter services. We're going to have two services, one at 7 o'clock in the morning and one at 9:30 in the morning. And after the 7 o'clock service, so around 8:10, somewhere in there, we'll have an Easter breakfast that'll start down in the fellowship hall. You're welcome to come and be a part of that. The Old Wheels group is putting on that Easter breakfast, and they'll be serving throughout the morning. So if you come to the later service, 9:30, you can come early. And they said they're going to serve until they run out of food. So if there's still food when that 9:30 service starts, you can come after that service, and you can still enjoy breakfast after that. So come and join us for Easter breakfast on Sunday morning. We're going to be doing in this service, in keeping with the tenebrae, we're going to be doing the offering very near to the beginning of the service. It's very early in the service. We'll do the offering while the choir is singing, and then the offering plates will be kept in the back, and then when we go into the tenebrae service, we won't be doing that. And we ask you to leave the sanctuary in silence tonight. I won't be greeting people in the back, so if you would leave in silence tonight, we'll turn on enough light that you can find your way out, see your way out. And then finally, you'll notice the cross that we always put up here. Every church has certain traditions that they have regarding special services, and one of the Good Friday traditions here is the wooden cross that you're invited, if you want to. No one needs to, no one has to, but if you would like to, you're welcome to come up during any of the hymns that we sing tonight, during any of that time, and you're welcome to come up and pound a nail into the cross as a reminder that it was our sins that put Jesus on the cross. And so there are hammers up here. There's a box with some nails in it, and you're welcome to come up and do that anytime we're singing. Most of the hymns we're only going to sing two verses of, but there are a few, like our opening hymn, that are a little bit, we're going to sing a little bit more. We'll sing four verses in our opening hymn. So anytime that we are singing, you can come up and do that. So those are all the announcements. If you would please rise, we're going to begin with a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, on this night when we remember the sacrifice that Jesus gave of himself on the cross, we pray that we might sacrifice our lives to him, and that we might seek to live and serve him. And the best thing about it is that when we give our lives to him, he gives us incredible joy and strength that comes from the indwelling of the Holy Spirit. And we thank you in his name. Amen. Our opening hymn tonight is now number 324. All of our words of our hymns will be on the cross, but number three, or on the cross, on the screen. On the screen, number 324, "In the Cross of Christ I Glory." The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us read responsively this reading from 1 Corinthians chapter 1. The word of the cross is folly to those who are perishing,
but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God.
The Jews demand signs and the Greeks seek wisdom,
but we preach Christ crucified,
but to those who are called, both Jews and Greeks,
Christ is the power of God and the wisdom of God.
For the foolishness of God is wiser than men,
and the weakness of God is stronger than men.
Let us pray this prayer together. Our Father in heaven, the characters around the cross remind us that we are all sinners in need of your grace. We thank you so much that you sent your Son, Jesus, to die on the cross for us. Wash away our sins in the blood of his sacrifice, and give us faith to believe that because he rose from the dead, we too will rise, and we will know the joy of eternal life in heaven. We ask this in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Please be seated, and we will receive our offering as the choir sings their anthem, "The Old Rugged Cross."
Thank you.
We now enter the darkness of the tenebrae service, and as we do, we remember that Jesus called us to deny ourselves, to take up our crosses, and to follow him. During the hymns of the tenebrae, as I mentioned, you are invited to come to the cross, pick up a nail and one of the hammers, and drive that nail into the wood of the cross. This is a reminder of Christ's sacrifice on the cross for our sake and of our commitment to follow him in our daily walk of life. Our first reading in the tenebrae service is about the darkness of conspiracy, and it is from Matthew chapter 26. When Jesus had finished all these sayings, he said to his disciples, "You know that after 2 days the Passover is coming, and the Son of Man will be delivered up to be crucified. Then the chief priests and the elders of the people gathered in the palace of the high priest, whose name was Caiaphas, and they plotted together in order to arrest Jesus by stealth and kill him. But they said, 'Not during the feast, lest there be an uproar among the people.' Then one of the 12, whose name was Judas Iscariot, went to the chief priests and said, 'What will you give me if I deliver him over to you?' And they paid him 30 pieces of silver. And from that moment, he sought an opportunity to betray him." Here ends our first reading. The first hymn that we will sing in our tenebrae is, "Alas, and Did My Savior Bleed?"
The second reading is the darkness of the unshared vigil from Matthew chapter 26. Then Jesus went with them to a place called Gethsemane, and he says to his disciples, "Sit here while I go over there and pray." And taking with him Peter and the two sons of Zebedee, he began to be sorrowful and troubled. Then he said to them, "My soul is very sorrowful, even to death. Remain here and watch with me." And going a little farther, he fell on his face and prayed, saying, "My Father, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as you will." And he came to the disciples and found them sleeping. And he said to Peter, "So, you could not watch with me for 1 hour? Watch and pray that you may not enter into temptation. The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak." Again, for the second time, he went away and prayed, "My Father, if this cannot pass unless I drink it, your will be done." Again he came, and he found them sleeping, for their eyes were very heavy. So leaving them again, he went away and prayed for the third time, saying the same words again. Then he came to the disciples and said to them, "Sleep and take your rest later on. See, the hour is at hand, and the Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of sinners. Rise, let us be going. See, my betrayer is at hand."
Thank you.
Our third reading is about the darkness of betrayal from Matthew 26, beginning at verse 47. While he was still speaking, Judas came, one of the 12, and with him a great crowd with swords and clubs from the chief priests and the elders of the people. Now the betrayer had given them a sign, saying, "The one I will kiss is the man. Seize him." And he came up to Jesus at once and said, "Greetings, Rabbi," and he kissed him. Jesus said to him, "Friend, do what you came to do." Then they came up and laid hands on Jesus and seized him. Here ends our reading. Our next hymn is "When I Survey the Wondrous Cross."
The next reading is the darkness of desertion and denial from Matthew 26, starting with verse 55. At that hour, Jesus said to the crowds, "Have you come out as against a robber with swords and clubs to capture me? Day after day I sat in the temple teaching, and you did not seize me. But all this has taken place that the scriptures of the prophets might be fulfilled." Then all the disciples left him and fled. Then those who had seized Jesus led him to Caiaphas, the high priest, where the scribes and the elders had gathered. And Peter was following him at a distance, as far as the courtyard of the high priest, and going inside, he sat with the guards to see the end. Now Peter was sitting outside in the courtyard, and a servant girl came up to him and said, "You also were with Jesus the Galilean." But he denied it before them all, saying, "I do not know what you mean." And when he went out to the entrance, another servant girl saw him, and she said to the bystanders, "This man was with Jesus of Nazareth." And again he denied it with an oath, "I do not know the man." After a little while, the bystanders came up and said to Peter, "Certainly, you too are one of them, for your accent betrays you." Then he began to invoke a curse on himself and to swear, "I do not know the man." And immediately the rooster crowed. And Peter remembered the saying of Jesus, "Before the rooster crows, you will deny me three times." And he went out and wept bitterly. Our next hymn is "Beneath the Cross of Jesus."
Thank you.
come to the darkness of accusation from Matthew 26 and 27. Now the chief priests and the whole council were seeking false testimony against Jesus that they might put him to death, but they found none, though many false witnesses came forward. At last, two came forward and said, "This man said, 'I am able to destroy the temple of God and to rebuild it in 3 days.'" And the high priest stood up and said, "Have you no answer to make? What is it that these men testify against you?" But Jesus remained silent. And the high priest said to him, "I adjure you by the living God, tell us if you are the Christ, the Son of God." Jesus said to him, "You have said so. But I tell you, from now on you will see the Son of Man seated at the right hand of power and coming on the clouds of heaven." Then the high priest tore his robes and said, "He has uttered blasphemy. What further witnesses do we need? You have now heard his blasphemy. What is your judgment?" They answered, "He deserves death." When morning came, all the chief priests and the elders of the people took counsel against Jesus to put him to death. And they bound him and led him away and delivered him over to Pilate the governor. Now at the feast, the governor was accustomed to release for the crowd any one prisoner whom they wanted. And they had then a notorious prisoner called Barabbas. The governor again said to them, "Which of the two do you want me to release for you?" And they said, "Barabbas." Pilate said to them, "Then what shall I do with Jesus, who is called Christ?" They all said, "Let him be crucified." And he said, "Why? What evil has he done?" But they shouted all the more, "Let him be crucified." Here ends our scripture reading.
The next reading is the darkness of crucifixion and death, which are the seven last words of Christ from all four Gospels. So they took Jesus, and he went out, bearing his own cross, to the place called the Place of a Skull, which in Aramaic is called Golgotha. There they crucified him, and with two others, one on either side, and Jesus between them. And Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." And they cast lots to divide his garments. And the people stood by watching. But the rulers scoffed at him, saying, "He saved others. Let him save himself, if he is the Christ of God, his chosen one." The soldiers also mocked him, coming up and offering him sour wine and saying, "If you are the King of the Jews, save yourself." Pilate also wrote an inscription and put it on the cross. It read, "Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews." Many of the Jews read this inscription, for the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city, and it was written in Aramaic, in Latin, and in Greek. So the chief priests of the Jews said to Pilate, "Do not write 'the King of the Jews,' but rather, 'This man said that I am the King of the Jews.'" Pilate answered, "What I have written, I have written." One of the criminals who were hanged railed at him, saying, "Are you not the Christ? Save yourself and us." But the other rebuked him, saying, "Do you not fear God, since you are under the same sentence of condemnation? And we indeed justly, for we are receiving the due reward of our deeds. But this man has done nothing wrong." And he said, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." And Jesus said to him, "Truly I say to you, today you will be with me in paradise." When Jesus saw his mother and the disciple whom he loved standing nearby, he said to his mother, "Woman, behold your son." Then he said to the disciple, "Behold your mother." And from that hour, the disciple took her into his own home. And when the sixth hour had come, there was darkness over the whole land until the ninth hour. And at the ninth hour, Jesus cried with a loud voice, "Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani," which means, my God, why have you forsaken me?" After this, Jesus, knowing that all was now finished, said, "I thirst." A jar full of sour wine stood there, so they put a sponge full of the sour wine on a hyssop branch and held it to his mouth. When Jesus had received the sour wine, he said, "It is finished." Then Jesus, calling out with a loud voice, said, "Father, into your hands I commit my spirit." And he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. And all the crowds that had assembled for this spectacle, when they saw what had taken place, returned home, beating their breasts.
During this season of Lent, we have been talking about a number of characters around the cross on our Wednesday night evening services. I continued that last night by covering another character on Maundy Thursday, Judas Iscariot. And tonight, I want to conclude this series by talking about three characters who were around the cross on the day that Jesus was crucified. Their names are Barabbas, Simon of Cyrene, and the Roman centurion. And I want to read just one scripture verse for you from Mark 15, verse 39. And when the centurion who stood facing him saw that in this way he breathed his last, he said, "Truly, this man was the Son of God." Grace be unto you and peace from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. I was talking earlier about the traditions that various churches have at different times of the year, different services, like our cross here with the nails. And at my former church, St. Mark Lutheran Church in Lindenhurst, Illinois, we had an interesting little tradition on the Good Friday service as well. We did the Tenebrae service like we're doing here tonight with all of the readings. But when we got to one particular reading, my colleague, Pastor Brem, would always ask the congregation to join in at one particular point in the readings. It was the reading where Pontius Pilate was trying to release Jesus because he knew that he was innocent. But the crowd of people who had gathered in the courtyard did not want Jesus to go free. So Pilate says to the crowd, "What do you want me to do with him?" And at that point, our whole congregation there would shout, "Crucify him! Crucify him!" And it was a powerful moment in that service. Well, one year, just before Good Friday, I was having a conversation with one of our church members, and she said to me, "You know, I don't really like it when we shout, 'Crucify him!' on Good Friday." And I was surprised by that, so I asked her, "Why don't you like to do that? What's the problem?" And she said, "Well, I don't feel like I would have shouted for his crucifixion if I had been in the crowd that day. Even if I didn't believe in him, I think I would have felt a little bit sorry for him. And I wouldn't have wanted to see him die on the cross." And she was probably right. She was a very kind-hearted person. She probably would not have wanted a public execution of a man she didn't even really know. But then I said to her, "You know, that's not really the point, though, of why we do it." I said, "We aren't shouting, 'Crucify him,' because we feel that that's what we would have done if we had been standing there that day. We shout because, like it or not, we are all responsible for the death of Jesus on the cross. We are all responsible because Jesus was dying for our sins." The Apostle Paul says that we have all sinned and have fallen short of the glory of God. He says that the wages of sin is death. Jesus had to pay the penalty for our sins. Jesus had to die in our place. And so we are there. We are shouting, "Crucify him," because it was our sins that nailed him to the cross. And that's why we have this tradition here of pounding a nail into the cross. We are part of the story of Good Friday. We are thrown into the events of that day because Jesus was dying for our sins before we were even born. So tonight I want to talk about three characters around the cross, three men who, like us, were thrown into the Good Friday story. And I want to see if we can learn something from each of these three characters about how we should respond to the Good Friday story in our own lives. The first person whose life was changed in a very unexpected way on Good Friday was a man by the name of Barabbas. When Barabbas woke up on that Friday morning, he thought that this was the day he was going to die. The Romans had three crosses ready to go that day, and most Bible commentators believe that one of those crosses was meant for Barabbas. The name Barabbas means "son of my father." He was daddy's boy, a chip off the old block. How did his life go so wrong? How did he end up on death row? Well, the Bible gives us a couple of clues. Matthew's gospel tells us that Barabbas was a notorious prisoner. Whatever he had done, he was well known for doing it. Mark's and Luke's gospels say that Barabbas was among the rebels in prison. So he was involved in some sort of protest or some sort of uprising in Jerusalem. It was probably an uprising against the Romans. And they both say that Barabbas had committed murder during the insurrection. John adds the little detail that he was also a robber, which means there was probably, in the insurrection, probably some looting going on. So this was quite a serious charge. This was exactly the sort of crime that the Romans crucified people for. Insurrection, you know, theft, causing a ruckus for the Roman Empire. But what Barabbas did not know was that there was a controversy brewing outside in the courtyard of the Roman governor, Pontius Pilate. The Jewish leaders had brought to Pilate a man named Jesus of Nazareth, and that they said that he claimed to be a king. And they demanded that Pilate give the order for this Jesus to be crucified. Now, it didn't take long for Pilate to realize that this man was no earthly king, that he was no revolutionary leader. Pilate felt that this was a religious dispute. The Jewish leaders did not like this man because of something that he was teaching. And Pilate had no desire to get in the middle of a religious squabble. And he didn't want to condemn an innocent man to death. So he got an idea. Every year at the Passover, Pilate gave a gift to the Jewish people. He released one of the political prisoners who were being held by the Romans. So he decided that he would offer to release Jesus. Surely some of his followers were out there in the crowd, and if they shouted loud enough for Jesus to be released, then Pilate could justify letting him go. But the followers of Jesus were not in the crowd that day, at least not in very large numbers. Most of them had run away, scared. None of his disciples were there. However, the friends of Barabbas were in that crowd. And when Pilate suggested releasing Jesus, they shouted, "No! Release to us Barabbas!" Barabbas was a man of action. He had struck a blow against Rome. He was a hero. But this Jesus was a failure. The previous Sunday, he came riding into Jerusalem on a donkey, and his followers were calling him the Messiah. But he didn't look very much like a Messiah this Friday morning, and so the crowds were disappointed in him, and they turned on him. No, they did not want Pilate to release Jesus. They wanted Pilate to release Barabbas. And so that is what Pilate did. Barabbas walked out of his cell that morning. He walked away from a death sentence, and another man would be carrying his cross. Another man would be taking his place. When I think about Barabbas, I'm reminded of how every one of us is just like him. We were sitting in our sins facing a death sentence. We were facing an eternity in hell, and then Jesus died for us 2,000 years before we were born. He offered us an incredible gift. He offered us the chance to live forever, and all we had to do to receive this gift was to believe in the giver. And when we do that, we walk out of that dark prison cell of death, and we walk into the brilliant light of forgiveness, the light of eternal life in heaven. So that's the first man that I want to talk about tonight, a man whose life was changed forever by Jesus on Good Friday. And then the second man whose life was changed was a man named Simon of Cyrene. Now, Simon was not a revolutionary like Barabbas. He had probably never seen the inside of a prison. He was a faithful Jewish man who just happened to be in Jerusalem for the Passover festival. Simon had grown up in the city of Cyrene, in a part of North Africa that today is part of the country of Libya. There was a significant Jewish population in that city. The Jews had spread throughout the Mediterranean world in a migration that came to be known as the diaspora. But no matter where the Jewish people roamed, their hearts were always thinking about the homeland, always thinking about their beautiful capital city of Jerusalem. In fact, it was the desire of every Jewish person outside of Israel to celebrate at least one Passover festival in Jerusalem at some point in their lives. They had a phrase to remind themselves of this longing. Whenever they would celebrate the Passover in the lands where they were living, they would say to each other, "Next year in Jerusalem." It was kind of like a Cubs fan saying, "Wait till next year." Well, just like the Cubs got their World Series in 2016, this was finally the year for Simon. He had traveled 1,200 miles to be here, and he was enjoying every minute of this festival. But on that Friday morning, as he was walking through the city, probably looking for a place to eat some breakfast, he encountered a huge crowd. They were lining the entire road, all the way from the palace of the Roman governor out to the west gate of the city. And Simon wondered what was going on, but he didn't have to wait very long to find out. Here came three men down the road. They were dragging the large wooden beams behind them, and Simon knew what those beams were for. The Romans were also the rulers in Cyrene, after all. These men were carrying the cross beams of the crosses on which they would be executed. But one of the men was really struggling under the weight of his beam. As he approached, Simon could see why. This man had been badly beaten. His body was a mass of torn flesh. Blood was dripping from him as he walked. What Simon didn't know was that Pilate had had Jesus flogged with a Roman whip called a scourge. It was a nasty little weapon with leather thongs that had metal beads sewn into them, and it could rip up a man's back with just a few blows. Pilate had ordered the scourging of Jesus, hoping that that would appease the Jewish leaders and that they would then agree to release him. But of course, that didn't work out. So here was Jesus, severely weakened from the beating, trying to carry that heavy crossbeam. Simon stuck his head out into the street to see better, and just then the bloody prisoner stumbled and dropped his cross. And suddenly Simon felt someone grab his arm. He turned around and looked right into the face of one of the hated Roman soldiers, and it was a frightening sight. And then the soldier said, "Pick up his cross and carry it for him." Simon did not protest. He knew that if you said no to a Roman soldier, you might end up on your own cross. So he picked up this poor man's cross, and he carried it down the road out of the western gate to a small hill that stood just outside of that gate. The hill was called Golgotha in Aramaic, which means the place of the skull. The Romans spoke Latin, and so they referred to the hill by its Roman name, its Latin name, Calvary. We don't know what Simon did after he carried the cross of Jesus. Did he hear what the people were saying about him? Did he sense that this was an innocent man being put to death because of the political concerns of the corrupt religious leaders? We don't know how much he understood. All we know is that, like Simon, God tells us to look on the suffering of Jesus. The Father compels us to see what the Son has done for us. And then he says to us, "I want you to pick up your cross in this world, whatever that cross may be, and I want you to carry it for Jesus." Just like Simon was told to carry the cross of Jesus, God wants us to serve each other in the name of the one who gave his life for us. Paul says in Galatians 6:2, "Bear one another's burdens and so fulfill the law of Christ." And I think Paul may very well have been thinking about the cross when he wrote those words. So Simon of Cyrene A faithful pilgrim from North Africa became a part of the greatest story ever told on that day. And we have some indication that his encounter with Jesus changed his life very much. The very fact that the gospel writers knew his name is a good indicator that he may have become a believer in Jesus after that fateful day. And we get another good clue in Mark 15:21. Mark says that Simon was the father of Alexander and Rufus. So they were known to the early Christian community. And that means that Simon's family may well have all become Christians. Some more evidence is found in Acts 11, verse 20, where we are told that there were some Cyrenian Christians in the church at Antioch. And finally, Paul mentions in Romans 16:13 a man named Rufus, who was a great comfort to him in Rome. And many scholars believe that this was the son of Simon of Cyrene, who was mentioned by Mark. So that is the second person whose life was changed on that day. And then there is a third person, a person whose name we do not know. He is only identified as the Roman centurion. A Roman centurion was a lower-level officer in the Roman army. He was the leader of 100 men. That's where the name centurion comes from. He was kind of equivalent to a sergeant in a modern army. Centurions were very close to their men, and they were usually very highly respected by them. They were some of the most experienced, some of the most battle-tested men in the entire army. For crucifixion duty, the centurion would choose three of his men, and the four of them, known as a quadrant, would be responsible for making sure that the executions were carried out professionally and without any hiccups. The most important job of all was to make sure that the condemned men were, to quote the coroner from The Wizard of Oz, really most sincerely dead. As a reward for doing crucifixion duty, the four soldiers were allowed to keep any clothing or personal items that belonged to the prisoners. That's why in John 19, the soldiers were dividing up the clothing of Jesus. They were tearing up the garments into four pieces. A strip of good cloth was valuable. You could either use it to patch your own clothing, or it could be traded for other items that you might need. But when they looked at the tunic of Jesus, they noticed that it was of one continuous piece of cloth. There were no seams where it could easily be torn. That was very unusual. That meant it was a very high quality garment. I imagine that someone special to him made it for him, whether his mother made it or whether it was one of the followers of Jesus who made it and gave it to him. And so they knew if they tried to tear it, that it would destroy a lot of its value. So the soldiers decided, let's cast lots for it, something like rolling dice. And as they were doing this, they did not realize that they were fulfilling an Old Testament prophecy about the Messiah. 1,000 years earlier, King David wrote in Psalm 22, a psalm that talks about the promised Messiah. He wrote this in verse 18. They divide my garments among them, and for my clothing they cast lots. And then 3 hours later at 12 noon, something very strange happened. Matthew 27:45 describes it this way. He says, now from the sixth hour, there was darkness all over the land until the ninth hour. The sixth hour of the Jewish day was 12 noon. The ninth hour was 3 p.m. These were the final 3 hours that Jesus was on the cross before he died. He was on the cross for 6 hours. These were the final three. Luke adds the detail that the sun's light failed. So it wasn't just like a cloudy day. This was like night in the middle of the afternoon. The Roman centurion, he knew that the charge against Jesus was that he had claimed to be the king of the Jews. He may have also been standing in the palace of Pontius Pilate when the religious leaders said to Pilate in John 19:7, we have a law, and according to that law he ought to die because he has made himself the Son of God. Matthew also records that Pilate's wife sent him a note saying, "Have nothing to do with this righteous man, for I have suffered much because of him today in a dream." Now, if the centurion has heard those things about Jesus, then he would have been very concerned when the sky suddenly went dark. It was as if God himself was grieving. And he would have heard the people around the cross, the ones shouting insults at Jesus, saying, "He saved others, why can't he save himself?" The centurion probably wondered, what do they mean by that? Who did this man save? What did this man do? The centurion couldn't think about that, though, right now. He just had to stay on task, get this crucifixion over with. But he could not help overhearing some of the things that Jesus said as he hung from the cross. While they were setting the cross into the ground, right as they were lifting up the cross, he heard Jesus say, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." It was like he was talking directly to God in heaven and forgiving those who were putting him to death. Later, Jesus said to one of the other men who was being crucified, he said, "Today you will be with me in paradise." Jesus is talking about heaven, as if he can grant that. Toward the end of the afternoon, Jesus shouted, my God, why have you forsaken me?" And that was it. This was the strangest crucifixion this centurion had ever seen. And he had seen many. He couldn't wait for this to be over. And then he heard Jesus say, "It is finished. Father, into your hands I commit my spirit." And he bowed his head, and he appeared to be dead. But how could that be? Crucifixions usually lasted for many hours. Sometimes men would last well into the next day. That was the point. It was supposed to be long-lasting and extremely painful. But this man had only been on the cross for 6 hours. And now it appeared that he had just died on command, said it's finished, and chose the moment that he would die. How was that possible? Was he really dead? There was a way to find out. The Romans had a special agreement with the Jewish leaders. The Jewish Sabbath began at sundown on Friday, and they had agreed that if any men were to be crucified on a Friday, they would make sure that they were dead and removed their bodies from the crosses before the sun went down. Now, of course, they couldn't see the sun right now. It was dark. But the centurion knew that it was about time. It had to be nearing sundown. He needed to get these men down. And so he went around to break their legs. The reason that a crucifixion could last so long was because the Romans gave the dying men a slanted piece of wood that they could stand on. And by pushing up against the wood with their legs, they could continue to stretch out their torso and grab quick breaths of air. And that would lengthen the time on the cross, keep them alive longer. But if you came around and broke the legs, they could no longer push themselves up. They could no longer breathe. Their bodies would just hang and compress their chests, and they would die very quickly. So they came to break the legs, and when they got to Jesus, it appeared that he was indeed dead already. But the centurion had to be sure. Do you know what would happen to a quadrant of soldiers if one of their prisoners survived the execution? The soldiers themselves would be put to death for failing their mission. That's why it had never, ever happened in the history of the Roman Empire. People did not survive crucifixions. The centurion took his spear and he plunged it into the side of Jesus. Water and blood gushed out of his lungs. He was dead. Suddenly, the earth began to shake. It was an earthquake. There had been earthquakes in that region before, but what were the odds of one happening right at the moment that this man had died? And that is when the Roman centurion, this battle-hardened warrior of the most powerful army on earth, looked up at a dead man on a cross and spoke the words that have echoed down through history. "Truly, this man was the Son of God." We don't know for sure what happened to the centurion after the crucifixion. We know that the Jewish leaders asked Pilate to place guards at the tomb of Jesus to prevent his followers from stealing his body. It's quite likely that Pilate assigned these same four men who had crucified Jesus to this strange guard duty, guarding a dead man. And if the centurion was one of those guards, then he would have been present on Easter Sunday morning when some of the women who had followed Jesus came to the tomb, hoping to anoint his body with burial spices. Matthew's gospel says at that moment there was a second earthquake. And then an angel appeared and rolled the stone away from the entrance of the tomb, and then the angel sat on the top of the stone. Matthew 28, 3 and 4 says, his appearance was like lightning and his clothing was white as snow. And for fear of him, the guards trembled and became like dead men. And they heard the angel say to the women, "Do not be afraid, for I know that you seek Jesus who was crucified. He is not here. He has risen." If the Roman centurion was a witness to all of those things, then he might very well have become a Christian after that weekend. We don't know for sure, but the name of the centurion, because the name of the centurion is never given in the Bible, but we do know that there were a number of Roman soldiers, including several centurions, who became Christians in the early Christian church. And it's a good bet that this man was one of them. I believe that his life was changed. And the centurion's story is a reminder to all of us that the power of the gospel can reach any person at any time from any walk of life. I hope that Barabbas was curious about this man who took his place on the cross. I hope that he looked into the story of this man and was saved by the grace of God through what he heard. We don't know for sure. I believe that Simon of Cyrene did become a believer, and that his sons after him also became strong believers and members of the early Christian church. And I think and I hope that that Roman centurion who witnessed the cross and the empty tomb also became a believer. But most of all, right here, right now, I hope that you believe in Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. I hope that you know what he has done for you on the cross, because if you do know that, then you will be in heaven one day and you will see Jesus face to face. And maybe you will eventually run into one of these people who were the characters around the cross. Amen and amen.
The darkness of the tomb, from the 27th chapter of Matthew, verse 57. When it was evening, there came a rich man from Arimathea named Joseph, who also was a disciple of Jesus. He went to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus. Then Pilate ordered it to be given to him, and Jesus took the body and wrapped it in a clean linen shroud and laid it in his own new tomb, which he had cut in the rock. And he rolled a great stone to the entrance of the tomb and went away.
A reading from Isaiah 53, verses 3 through 6. He was despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. And as one from whom men hide their faces, he was despised, and we esteemed him not. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God, and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the chastisement that brought us peace, and with his wounds we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all.
Oh.